virtual public hearing concerning Santee Cooper's critical area permit application for the installation of a transmission line approximately 5 miles in length. This project is located on Johns Island in Charleston County. I am Tara Maddock, a program coordinator with DHEC's Office of Ocean and Coastal Resource Management. I will be serving as the meeting host for tonight's virtual hearing. There are also several other people on our tech team assisting me tonight. I will ask them to introduce themselves now.
Good evening, everyone. This is Catherine Yon.
Hello, this is Christy Ellenberg.
Hi, this is Laura Boyce.
In just a few minutes, you will also be introduced to several other DHEC staff who are also involved in tonight's virtual hearing. We are using this technology to provide opportunities for continued participation in our decision-making processes, while we all do our part to reduce the spread of coronavirus by following current federal and state guidelines that promote social distancing. We want to make sure we hear from all who are interested. As the state's public health agency, we must make public health and safety a priority. We do encourage you to help stop the spread of COVID by washing your hands, staying home when you are sick, covering your coughs, and keeping surfaces clean. Most importantly, stay up to date and stay informed of COVID-19 by visiting our website, scdhec.gov/COVID-19. Your participation is important to us, so we have gone to extensive efforts to ensure that anyone who is interested in engaging with us has the ability to do so. We are continuing to evaluate the tools and accommodations, and we do welcome your input on how we may be able to improve your experience with virtual participation. Please give us your thoughts in the feedback survey that will be posted on our webpage after tonight's meeting. We encourage you to close other applications running on your computer and turning off other streaming services or devices at your location for the duration of the virtual hearing. All lines have been muted in order to minimize background noise and echoing so that everyone can hear those speaking. We ask that you please keep your lines muted until you are called on during the time for public comment. Instructions on how to unmute will be provided at that time. Agency staff will not respond to any written comments shared in the chat. Anything typed into the chat is visible to all attendees and may be subject to be included in the record of the public hearing. Instead, please submit all written comments to the department by visiting scdhec.gov Santee Cooper, Johns Island, and clicking Submit a Comment under Downloads and Links. The virtual hearing will be recorded, and the recording will be placed on our webpage within the next few days. We can start the recording now. We have started the recording. Blair Williams will be serving as your hearing officer tonight, and Laura Boyce will assist after the presentation with additional instructions for the comment portion of the hearing. Okay, Blair, if you are ready, I think we can go ahead and get started.
Good evening. My name is Blair Williams, and I am the manager of OCRM's Critical Air Permitting Section of the Department of Health and Environmental Control. At this time, I would like to recognize Josh Hoke, who is the project manager for this request and in attendance tonight. DHEC's Office of Ocean and Coastal Resource Management's general charge is to protect the quality of the coastal environment and to promote economic and social improvement of the coastal zone. This mandate includes the wise management of coastal resources through the review of projects that propose impacts to those resources, including tidal wetlands in the eight coastal counties. Through the Coastal Zone Management Act, the department's critical area regulations, and coastal zone consistency certification review. The critical area permitting responsibility of DHEC is the basis for this public hearing tonight, and our review is initiated upon receipt of a critical area permit application, which was placed on public notice. This public notice is the document that most of you receive. The public notice advertised the proposed project consists of installing a new 115 kV transmission line, approximately 5.17 miles in length, connecting the existing Johns Island substation to Dominion Energy's Church Creek Queensboro transmission line. The new line will be built in accordance with the North American Electric Reliability Corporation standard and mostly parallels the existing transmission lines. A new 100-foot right-of-way will be established along the proposed route, except where the line parallels the existing SCPSA Matiba Johns Island line, requiring an additional 55 feet of right-of-way. The transmission lines will be elevated to the same height or higher than the existing transmission lines on metal transmission poles installed by way of vibratory casing. The purpose of the project is to improve reliability of the power grid. The project is located on Johns Island in Charleston County, South Carolina. Please be advised, the project length of the project has been reduced by the applicant by 1.2 miles from the original public notice. The area shown in black on the revised project study area map is the portion of the project that has been removed from the original public notice. The area shown in red is the revised project study area. Please be aware that the red area is a boundary and is not showing two transmission lines. The next few slides depict the location of the proposed activity associated with the Tidelands critical area impacts, identified by a shaded cross hatch, and is the scope of the department's review under this critical area permit application. It is the responsibility of the department to accept applications and review them in an unbiased manner, as staff is charged with interpreting state law and regulations. No decision is made until such time as the file is administratively complete and until all necessary facts have been gathered. In that regard, this hearing is designed to gather comments as to the merits of the project and consider all information when making a decision based on the Coastal Zone Management Act, department regulations, and policies. As stated above, the impacts to the Tidelands critical area is the scope of the department's review under this critical area permit application. The specific regulations that will be reviewed for this project will be Regulation 30-11 B and C, which are standards that apply to all projects, and Regulation 30-12 D, which are the regulations specific to cables, pipelines, and transmission lines. Additionally, staff will base the decision upon applicable policies in the Coastal Zone Management Plan. For your reference, there are electronic copies of the public notice postcard and the submitted drawings showing the proposed modifications in both a plan view and cross-section view available for download at scdhec.gov/Santee Cooper Johns Island and clicking the public notice link under downloads and links. Once we begin the public comment portion of the hearing, we will invite all persons that registered to speak to make a statement for the record first. Afterward, we will invite any others to comment, and instructions on how to do so will be provided at that time. The only remarks allowed will be from the person called to speak. Each speaker will be allowed 4 minutes, and each speaker may only speak one time. I would advise those who plan to speak to limit your comments to the project at hand, which is to construct new electrical transmission lines. Please remember the purpose of this hearing is to allow interested persons to make a statement for the record, which will be reviewed by OCRM staff prior to a decision. For the sake of accuracy, important facts should be submitted in writing. Please submit comments by visiting scdhec.gov/Santee Cooper Johns Island and clicking Submit a Comment under Downloads and Links. You may also submit comments by way of mail or email through October 28, 2020 to DHEC OCRM, Attention Josh Hoke, 1362 McMillan Avenue, Suite 400, Charleston, South Carolina, 29405, or by email at hokejd@dhec.se.gov. To make certain we gather all presented information, direct questioning during the hearing will not be allowed. Laura, I think we're ready to begin the public comment portion of this evening's hearing.
Hey, Blair, this is Catherine. Real quick, there have been several people in the comments who have said that they are not able to view the presentation. So I just wanted to let everyone know that it has been added to the chat as a file called presentation. And Laura also included a link to our webpage in the chat where the presentation is going to be added momentarily.
Thanks, Catherine. Yes, thanks, Blair. We will go ahead and get started with the public comment portion of tonight's hearing. Let's see, I want to make sure we're on the right slide here. Great, thank you. So I will be calling on those of you who indicated during pre-registration that you would like to speak to make a comment. When it's your turn, please clearly state and spell your name and identify any organization or group that you may be providing your comment on behalf of. Remember to unmute your line by clicking the microphone on your screen or by using star 6 if you're joining us by phone. Please be reminded that you will have a 4-minute time limit to present your comments. At the end of 4 minutes, a chime will sound. And we ask that you finish those final thoughts so that we may have time for all who have requested to speak tonight. If for some reason you're experiencing difficulty with muting or unmuting your line, we encourage you to call in to the hearing. That information has been provided in the chat. The phone number and the access code is in the meeting chat as well as on our webpage. We also encourage you to submit your comments in writing by visiting www.scdhec.gov/Santee Cooper Johns Island and clicking Submit a Comment on the right-hand side of the screen. Okay, I will start by calling on Jason Crowley, and then I'll call on Melissa Chaplin and Adam Smolka. Once we get to your name, we will allow you to unmute and allow you to go ahead and make your comment. Please refrain from making your comment until we do call on you. So first we will start with Jason Crowley.
Good evening, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can. Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Jason Crowley, Director of Communities and Transportation for the Coastal Conservation League, 131 Spring Street. We would like to take a moment to acknowledge the fact that Santee Cooper had originally proposed their transmission line to start south of Maybank Highway, and the original location would have had a pretty significant impact to the gateway of Johns Island at the entrance along Maybank Highway at the base of the bridge, and would have removed numerous trees on the buffer of the neighborhood at the entrance to John's Island, which would have exposed quite a few residences in an area where there's been a great deal of effort to buffer that and preserve the natural view and essence as you come onto the island. And through the relocation further to the north of the new connection point, not only does it preserve that cultural and ecological significance at the gateway to John's Island, but it also minimizes the impacts to Penny Creek in a pretty substantial portion. We recognize that there are still some concerns and discrepancies with nearby residences around Rushland Landing Road and near Swan Landing, and we hope that Santee Cooper will be able to work with those communities to further minimize those visual impacts and the impacts to the natural resources in that area. But we are pleased with the improvements that have been made since the previous public notice went out, and overall support the plan as presented. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, I will call on Melissa Chaplin. Ms. Chaplin, if you can unmute and state your name and any organization you may be with.
Hello, my name is Melissa Chaplin, and I am just calling in to represent my family, who are residents along Simmons Creek in Swigert's Landing, and also some fellow neighbors along Rurick Road. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, ma'am, we sure can.
Okay. So I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I have already submitted comments on the original route, and I plan to submit additional written comments and supplemental documentation. So I'm going to keep my comments brief. Wanted to highlight something that I know Jason has already mentioned. I do recognize that the revised project route eliminates 1.2 miles of the original route and avoids approximately, hard to tell exactly with the drawings, but potentially 15 plus acres of tidal wetlands and 1.2 acres of tidal waters, which does eliminate the vast majority of the tidal wetland and waters impacts. However, the portion of the proposed route that was rerouted back in 2019 to avoid the retreat, one of Eastwood Homes' undeveloped residential housing projects, will result in 23.4 acres of wetland impact. 5.8 of those are tidal, and then 17.7 are non-tidal, and 0.3 acres of tidal creek impacts to Simmons Creek. Santee Cooper has paid Eastwood Homes $450,000 for an easement across 3.43 acres of wetlands. So Eastwood Homes' development plans are unimpeded, and they are able to make about $450,000 off of wetlands that they are not able to develop. It's really unfortunate resources are being impacted to minimize economic impacts to a planned but undeveloped residential neighborhood on upland. Santee Cooper currently does not have an easement for where the proposed route crosses Swigert's Landing property owner's property, and they will not be given one unless access is granted through the eminent domain process or Santee Cooper reroutes the line around the Swigert's Landing Property Owners Association property. Therefore, they cannot provide an affidavit of ownership or control for this portion of the route. And one question that I'll just leave you with is Santee Cooper able to document that all easements have been secured along the entire proposed route at this time? I thank you for this opportunity to speak. And as I mentioned, I will be submitting additional comments and documentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Chaplin, and we really do appreciate you submitting your comments and writing especially. Next, we will call on Mr. Adam Smolka, And after Mr. Smolka, we will hear from Joyce Bradshaw. Mr. Smolka, if you are on the phone, you can unmute by pressing *6. If you're joining us through your computer, you should be able to see a microphone icon at the top, and you can click that to unmute.
Laura, Mr. Smolka was having some audio issues on his device, and we have provided him with the call-in number, so we may want to give him a minute to get dialed in.
Okay. We may go to Ms. Bradshaw and come back to Mr. Smolka while he dials in. Is Ms. Joyce Bradshaw available?
Yes.
Great. You have 4 minutes if you can clearly state your name and any organization that you may be representing.
My name is Joyce Bradshaw. I've spoken to Sandy Cooper on several occasions, and I am somewhat mystified as to how they came to identify the present power grid the way it is indicated on the screen. It seems to have a very definite purpose where they appear to avoid some property owner's property and sort of dump on other owner's property. And it seems like it's almost a grid that has already been taken care of in terms of their purpose. And I wonder if there is a logical indication to completely destroy some owner's properties in preference to others. That's number one. Number two, the grid path appears to be so definite. Have you already gained ownership of that grid pathway? And what would it indicate? Why would you certainly discontinue 1.2 miles of your grid over wetlands, swamp and marsh, where it would not affect people's living? Why would that? Could it be that because all the very rich people will be looking at your ugly grid, your power lines, and that is enough for you to delete that 1.2 miles of power line? So I am very mystified as to why some people are selected, some properties are selected to take all the burden of your intrusive 100 feet is a very wide swath of land. A major road like Brownswood Road is only 50 feet and is supported by the state. 100 feet is a lot of land, and you're talking about lots of small landowners on John's Island. It is made of small tracts of land, and 100 feet is very intrusive to some, to the point where you can almost make the piece of property take away all the economic use of people's private property. So I would like to see if you can make some sense of, perhaps spread the misery a bit instead of dumping on some poor landowners. Thank you. I appreciate the time to speak.
Thank you so much for your comments, Ms. Bradshaw. Is Mr. Smolka available on the phone? If you are,
yes,
press star 6.
I am available.
Great. Please provide your name clearly for us and any organization you may be representing tonight.
So, good afternoon. My name is Adam Smolka. I represent myself and the neighbors on Rushland and Mews. That's on the marsh at Murray and Penny's Creeks. And if I may be allowed to make some comments, I will start right here. Before I do, I can't see any video. Can you tell me how I can get video on this connection?
If you're on your computer, there is a little camera icon up at the top that you can click.
Sorry, that would turn. Are you wanting to turn on your video, or are you wanting to see what's being presented, Mr. Smolka?
I've not been able to see anything except the PowerPoint slides, 15 PowerPoint slides, but I couldn't hear anything. And I finally just called in. That's what I'm doing just now.
Okay.
All I see on my computer screen right now is just one of the slides.
Yes, sir. That's actually all that's been presented as a PowerPoint. And I apologize for your audio issues. There is going to be a recording of this that we will provide, but you have not missed anything in terms of video. It has just been the PowerPoint.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for that explanation. I want to commend DHEC for rescheduling this public hearing because it gives us more time to study the issues. Our well-being depends on many things, and most of us will agree that enjoyment of a pristine natural environment is high on the list. That's why we choose to live on John's Island. Pristine means untouched, as nature intended. Installation of 5 miles of high voltage transmission lines supported by 75 foot metal pylons is a major intrusion on the natural environment. Justification for such an intrusion must meet a high standard. I'd like to comment on 3 concerns that I have about this project. Inadequacy of the Santee Cooper documentation supporting the permit, impact of power lines and property values, and impacts on local flora and fauna and their biodiversity. So let's start with inadequate documentation. I first heard about the project from Jason Crowley of the Coastal Conservation League on July the 9th, 2020, just 2 weeks before a deadline for comments and requests for a public hearing. Jason told me that Santee Cooper has not been very public about this project, and people don't seem to know what is going on since the meeting they hosted 2 years ago. We've been trying to get updated information from them for months and never got anything until this public notice went out last week. We believe there needs to be way more public information and engagement than there has been to date. So I really appreciated the heads up, but my neighbors and I had only a few days to study the implications. However, the Santee Cooper documentation posted by DHEC defied clear understanding. It was neither detailed nor comprehensive, consisted only of a postcard that outlined the justification and route of the power line, and 14 small resolution maps with various technical annotations. We've all seen those. Meaningful discussion of a project with such major visual and environmental impacts requires expertise in engineering, ecology, wetlands conservation, and wildlife management. The submitted documents don't reference any existing or proposed feasibility studies or environmental impact studies relating to the abundant flora and fauna in the tidal wetlands traversed by the power line. I concur with the Coastal Conservation League that considerably more public information and community engagement and provided so far is essential before consensus can be reached on this project. The only public justification for the new power line is improvement of power grid reliability on John's Island. Santee Cooper hasn't provided evidence or documentation of studies it has carried out or commissioned that support this contention. Nor have interested parties been given access to any resulting data that would allow impartial objective study leading to informed opinion on the validity of any conclusions. The application is on possible benefits for a new power line. What does that alert mean? I hope my time is not up because there's a couple more points I'd like to make.
Yes, Mr. Smolka, I apologize. That is the end of 4 minutes, but we would really like to see your comments in writing. You've raised some really important issues here, and we certainly do want to include those into the record.
I beg your pardon. Nowhere have I seen documentation that speakers are limited to 4 minutes.
I believe it was mentioned in the opening statement, and you may have not heard it because you were calling in. I do apologize.
Well, there has to be a better mechanism for allowing community input on a matter of such fundamental importance to our way of life on John's Island. So I'm very distressed that you cannot give me just a few more minutes to address one or two additional points.
Certainly, yes, sir. We do have a few other folks on the list, but I would love to hear what you have to say. Could we give you 30 more seconds, and if that doesn't come back after the others have signed up, have a chance to speak?
Let's think about alternative routes. For example, using existing utility rights of way on dry lands along Murray Wood Road, River Road, and Maybank Highway would be more economical and practical in terms of access and maintenance, in addition to mitigation of adverse environmental impact on tidal wetlands. In particular, rerouting the power line to the north shoulder of Murray Wood Road, crossing River Road at Rushland Landing Road, and continuing east across uninhabited marsh to tie into the Dominion line would minimize proximity to existing homes and would allow more convenient access to rights of way for periodic maintenance and repair. If crossing Murray and Penny's Creeks is imperative and can be justified, the option of burying the line under both creeks and Brickyard Road should be rigorously studied. This approach would protect that section of the line from destructive tornadoes and hurricanes that our coastal region is increasingly vulnerable to. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Smolka. And again, I will emphasize that we certainly do appreciate those comments that we are hearing orally. And if you would, we would encourage you to submit them in writing as well. Thank you so much.
I have submitted these comments and more in writing, fully documented. And if there's any additional time left after the other speakers have made their input, I would appreciate if you could call on me again before 8 o'clock. Thank you so much.
Certainly, thank you. There will be an opportunity after we hear from all who have pre-registered for those who have indicated who would like to speak, who may not have indicated initially that they would like to speak. They will have an opportunity at that point too. If there is still time after them, we will certainly call on you, Mr. Smolka. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next, we will hear from Mr. John LeMasters. After Mr. LeMasters, we will hear from Daniel Palmer. Mr. LeMasters, if you're joining us by phone, you can use *6 to unmute.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, my name is John LeMasters. I live at 1301 Chardon Commons in the Rushland Landings development. And I'm representing myself. I would just ask if anyone has ever visited northern New Jersey. Well, I have, and it has beautiful tidal marshes there, but they're sullied by the crisscrossing of power lines and other unfortunate development. And what most concerns me is I'd hate to see a New Jerseyfication of John's Island. It always puzzles me why I can understand why power lines have to cross from one island to the other island, but why do the power lines have to follow the lengthwise of the tidal marshes as the power line does along Penny Creek? It's just a blight on a beautiful vista. The drawings that you provided to me are inadequate because they don't show what these power towers will look like. In the drawings, they say a pole here, a pole there, But it's not just a single poll. I don't know what it will be. And I would ask, what is being done to abate the blight, the visual blight of these structures? Can they be single pole construction as we see along Folly Road and on the peninsula? Can the poles be painted a color to blend in with the tidal marsh and the surrounding woodlands? None of this is considered or presented. And I think this is very important for the quality of life and for our local economy that relies so much on tourism. So, and lastly, I've seen parts of Adam Smolka's letter and say that I very much support that, and a very thoughtful letter, and I hope you all take it to heart, and thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you so much, Mr. LeMasters. We do appreciate those comments. Next, we will hear from Mr. Daniel Palmer. And after Mr. Palmer, we will hear from Horton Bart. Mr. Palmer, if you are on the phone, you can unmute by using *6. And please state your name clearly and any organization you may be representing.
I have no comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Palmer. Next, we will hear from Horton Bart. And after Mr. Bart, we will hear from Teresa Hensley. Mr. Bart, you may unmute by using *6 if you're on the phone or clicking the microphone icon at the top of your screen. Do we have Mr. Horton Bart? I'm not hearing anyone or seeing a raised hand or an unmute. We will try to come back to Mr. Bart. Is Ms. Teresa Hensley available?
Good evening.
Hi, Ms.
My name is Teresa Hensley. I'm the senior manager of Santee Cooper's project management group. And on behalf of Santee Cooper, I would like to thank DHEC and OCRM for hosting tonight's meeting. And I would also like to thank the public for their participation in the permit process through the written comments received thus far, the verbal comments received tonight, and the follow-up written comments to be received. Thank you again, and I look forward to hearing from everyone.
Thank you, Ms. Hensley. I will go back to see if Mr. Horton Bart has joined us. Again, if you're on your phone, you can use *6 to unmute. If you're on your computer or an electronic device, you can click the microphone icon on the toolbar at the top of the screen. Mr. Bart, I'm not hearing you. If you are trying to comment, I encourage you to call in and use the phone line so that we can hear you. I am going to move on to the opportunity for those who did not register to provide a comment. Mr. Bart, if you join us, please indicate such by either unmuting your line and we will be able to recognize that, or using your hand raise icon on the toolbar. We will now provide an opportunity for those of you who did not register but would like to provide a comment for the record. In a moment, I will ask anyone who would like to be recognized to please indicate as such. You can do so by raising your hand by clicking on the hand icon in the toolbar, or if you have called into the meeting, please unmute your line by pressing *6. Our tech team will be watching for raised hand and unmuted phone lines. Once you've raised your hand or unmuted your line, please refrain from speaking until you're called on, either by your name or by the last four digits of your phone number. If we experience a lot of background noise, we may need to mute lines. When it is your turn to speak, please clearly state and spell your name. Okay, at this time, please either raise your hand if you're joining us by computer or unmute using *6 if you've joined by phone. I see we have Ms. Noreen Powers raising her hand. If you wouldn't mind.
Yes, this is Noreen Powers, and I am representing myself and my family. I have actually lived on John's Island here for over 15 years, and oddly enough, I've really just heard about this project in July when the public notice came out, and it kind of surprised me because this power line will be something that I see when I pull out of my driveway. It'll be my prominent view when I sit out in my backyard. So not to have heard one drop from Santee Cooper, I think is honestly just insulting. But I know that the purpose of this meeting is the OCRM permit review. So I would like to just kind of perhaps point out a couple of items that in my mind would actually deny this permit. I do find it odd that DHEC accepts a project of this magnitude and impact on poorly prepared 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper, of which these critical delineated critical areas typically are on the far edge of any one of the pages. I don't believe these drawings meet any form of the requirements of showing the property lines, the property tax ID numbers, et cetera. And in addition to that, it seems that from your PowerPoint tonight, the plans have changed. So I think from when I first saw this in July, they did remove a little over a mile, and I applaud that for certain, but removing that does no way eliminates the damages that are still going to happen to Penny's Creek and the tributary on it. But so I'm not quite sure what plans we're reviewing. I agree with the previous caller's comments about just the lack of detail, like pole 45, pole 44, pole 46. And now that there's a new set that is on your PowerPoint, I'm going to have to go back and review those compared to what you have, because it seems like more details have been removed rather than added. So again, I just find it odd that 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper, of which 30% of the page includes logos and legends, and honestly, very little bit of information as far as distances to structures, distances to docks. So for that reason, you know, I just really believe that this permit should be denied. And also it seems that in these critical areas, the wetland areas are very neatly shown in rectangular boxes. I think we're all aware that naturally wetlands do not occur that way. So it's unclear to me whether these wetlands have just been picked up from mapping, or if someone has actually gone out and done a wetlands delineation. And again, even though they're in nice, neat little squares, I think we can all probably admit that the damages will extend beyond the areas shown. So again, I really would request that DHEC do a very serious review of these plans. And as I see it, they don't meet the requirements for approval. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Powers. Very important comments. Thank you so much for saying those comments. We are seeing several people who may be calling on the phone and are trying to unmute. If you use your phone's mute button, that does not unmute the line. We really need you to use *6, and that will be able to unmute it in the system that is being used for the meeting tonight. So if you're on your phone, please use *6 to unmute your line, and we will call your name in the order that we see those lines come unmuted. If we mute you back, it just means that we will call on you in when it is your turn. Right now, we will ask for Mr. John, is it Basak?
Basak, yes.
Thank you.
Taking my input, I'm a homeowner in the preserve at Fenwick Plantation. I live right along Penny Creek. And I'm glad Therese was on the phone from the utility company. And my question, a lot of really good comments here, but my question is, my view shed is going to be retarded by this impact of the lines taking trees down right along Penny Creek as approaches Maybank. And how, as a homeowner, will I be compensated? Is my primary, because it seems like you are going to do this, so my view shed is going to be negatively impacted, and I would be compensated for it. So I'm going to know how that's going to take place. That was it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Basak. Next, we will hear from Carl Brady.
Yep, can you hear me?
I sure can. Thank you.
Great, thank you. My name is Carl Brady. I'm the city council member for District 5 for the city of Charleston. So I represent Johns Island and Outer West Ashley. And I want to, first of all, thank everyone that's called in for the public hearing. And then just as it relates to the hearing, I do applaud taking the 1.2 miles off and working with the Conservation League to try and minimize the impacts. But I would just beseech, DHEC as a regulatory agency to continue trying to minimize the wetland impacts and to work with the affected homeowners as well. And then as far as the utility company and for myself as a representative of the city, being able to see specifically the types of poles and what's going to be implemented, I think would go a long way, especially if those impacts can be minimized, because obviously the utility has condemnation authority. The land can be taken anyway, but I would like to see, to the previous caller's point, to make sure that homeowners that are affected are justly compensated, but also any of the impacts that would be attributable to the power lines, disrupting views and that type of thing are taken into account as well. And I'm work with the homeowners associations to help with those property owners. So I appreciate the time and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brady. We may mute your lines back as we hear any background noise. We will call on everyone who has indicated that they would like to make a comment. Next, we will hear from phone number ending in 4872.
So that's my phone number. This is Adam Smolka again from Russian Muse. Thank you for coming back to me. I appreciate that very much. I previously spoke briefly on the inadequacy of documentation provided by Santee Cooper, and I'm delighted to hear that the representative from Santee Cooper has been on the line. Teresa, I believe, was your name. Thank you for your comments. I would like to address one of my other concerns, which is the impact of the power line on home values. The attrition of home value, if the power line is constructed, is of high concern to residents of Swigert's Landing and Rushton Landing, and indeed my little community in Rushton Mews. Cardinal yardstick for residential value is location, 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 and certainly the development of the marshes at Rushton Landing, where I've lived for almost 15 years, has been predicated on this community's proximity and access to the pristine landscape of Penny's and Murray's Creek. Many peer-reviewed studies have examined the impacts of high-voltage power lines on home value, and I've documented many of those studies in the comments that I'm sending formally to DHEC. The bottom line of most of these studies is that home value, single-family home values, decreased by 38%, 100 meters from a power line. a study of over 5,000 vacant lots in Pickens County indicated that adjacency to new high-voltage power lines resulted in 45% attrition in lot volume. The last point that I wanted to address, and it's probably my most lengthy comment, so I will not be able to get through much of what I said in my submitted comments, but the major concern is the potential adverse impact on the broad spectrum of wildlife that inhabits the waters and the marshlands bordering Pennies and Murray and Simmons Creeks. This includes water birds and nearshore birds, doves, woodpeckers, on and on and on, the dozens of species. Non-bird impacts, let's think about that. There have been 95 reports to date of diamondback terrapin between 3 and 5 miles of the coordinates cited in the Santee Cooper application. These coastal estuarine turtles are listed as vulnerable, defined as facing a high risk of extinction in the wild in the immediate future. Coming closer to home, my street, we have at least 2 small colonies of painted buntings living on the marsh in Rushton Mews. The numbers of these finches have been dropping for several decades. The North American Breeding Bird Survey estimated an average decline of 3.2% a year between 1996 and 1995. Overall, a 62% population decline over that time. The eastern population in particular is suffering from habitat loss and degradation as urban development destroys swampy thickets and woodland edges. I could go on. There are specific problems with power lines, including the physical barrier to migration of birds, electrocution, landscape fragmentation. This is where power lines interrupt landscape connectivity and the problem that poses for animals. And then we've got the highly debated impact of electromagnetic fields. And there are many studies that can be referenced, and I've included them in my submitted comments, that show essentially the bottom line is that a safe level of a general public precautionary level, safe level, is 0.5 milligauss at a minimum distance of 700 feet from 115 kilovolt power line. Several homes and recreational facilities, that's private docks and navigational creeks, adjacent to the proposed route of this line are less than 700 feet from the proposed high voltage conductors. I have taken up so much of your time, and I'll pause for now. Thank you very much. If there's any more time after everybody else has had a chance, I have one last comment I'd like to make. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Smolka. I do appreciate those extra comments. And if we do have time, we will try to come back to you to finish up the last comment that you have.
Thank you.
I do see that we have at least one other person that has indicated they would like to make a comment. Ms. Melissa Chaplin, I believe we've heard from you earlier, but we do have time to come back to you.
Hello, yes, this is actually Mr. Chaplin, and want to touch base on a couple of things. Mrs. Powers, thank you for your comments. We do appreciate them. It is been relayed to us and some of our neighbors said that my wife was muted as soon as the dollar amount was mentioned. This is a public hearing and that information was obtained through a FOIA request. It is public information in the interest of the public. Can anyone explain why that information was muted at that time?
Mr. Chaplin, I'm not sure that we were aware of that. And if you have that information, we welcome that to be provided at this moment.
It was the, where are we at, honey? I'm sorry, my wife's coming back to this. Santee Cooper paid Eastwood Homes $450,000 for an easement of 3.43 acres of wetlands. So Eastwood Home developed plans are unimpeded and they make $450K off of wetlands they cannot develop. we just wanted to make sure that was on record, because like I said, some of our neighbors were unable to hear that, and as soon as money was mentioned, it kind of muted out.
I heard that. I actually heard that amount. So it was definitely not muted, because okay. I heard that amount.
Okay. That's all we wanted, just to bring that back up and make sure that we were all on the same page.
Yes, I do appreciate you mentioning that so that it did get on the record. Could we get your first name, Mr. Chaplin?
My name is Justin, J-U-S-T-I-N.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time, I don't see anyone else indicating they would like to make an oral comment. If you would like to make an oral comment for the record, please unmute your line using star 6 or use the hand raise icon if you are joining us through an electronic device. If you're experiencing any difficulty with muting or unmuting your line, we do encourage you to submit your comments in writing by visiting scdhec.gov/Santee Cooper Johns Island and click submit a comment over on the right hand side of the screen. Also, as we mentioned earlier, the agency will not respond to any written comments shared in the chat. Anything typed into the chat is subject to be included in the record of the public hearing, but may not be included as an official comment to be included in the decision making of this project. I don't see any other attendees indicating they would like to make a comment.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I was trying to do the hand raise. It wasn't working for me. This is Councilmember Anna Johnson from Charleston County. And yes, I just wanted to acknowledge my presence here. I have joined you because of a few calls and emails that I was receiving from some of the Johns Island residents. And they expressed some concerns about proper permits for trees and concerns about the wetlands, and also the power line usage of that versus the wetlands. So just wanted to let you know I was listening, and I've learned some things because I didn't know very much about this project. And I thank you for allowing the residents to be able to express their comments and concerns here, because that was one of the things also I was hearing about. So I'm just looking forward to hearing and learning more as this project progresses on. Thank you.
Certainly. Thank you so much for joining us, Ms. Johnson. We do appreciate those comments and the support that you're giving for the citizens here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I see, I don't see anyone else indicating they would like to make an oral comment for the record. So I do believe we have some time. Mr. Smolka, would you like to provide your final comments so that we can have those on the official record?
Thank you so much. I'm delighted that Ms. Johnson has joined the meeting. We need to have the highest level of awareness of our elected representatives, and I look forward to having further communications with such individuals. What I tried to do in earlier remarks this evening was to highlight some of the potential negative impacts of the power line. I mentioned deficiencies in documentation. One of the major issues there, as I think I mentioned, was lack of proper, what I consider to be proper justification for the line. We are told that it is to improve the reliability of the grid on Johns Island. In fact, I consider the reliability to be pretty good. Every now and again, we get a power outage, and that happens everywhere. especially under the climate conditions we're living in. I don't see any particular documentation that makes this a particular justification for having the line. In fact, somebody told me that it was simply building redundancy. Well, we don't need redundancy if everything is working pretty well as it is. So the final comment I want to make is I request that DHEC's further consideration of the application be informed by more comprehensive, formal Santee Cooper analysis of the project's environmental and human repercussions. Such analysis should include detailed justification for the necessity of the new power line, justification of the proposed route, and technical discussion of the merits or otherwise of alternative routes suggested by me and others. The communities impacted by this project and who will live with the consequences far into the future require and deserve full transparency of the design and the planning process behind this application. Thanks so much for holding this public hearing. Thank you for putting up with my extensive remarks. And I want to thank everybody who participated and contributed their own concerns and fears about this project. Thank you so much and have a good evening.
Thank you so much, Mr. Smolka. We do appreciate your willingness to jump on the phone to make sure that those comments are heard and for allowing us to come back to you several times. Those comments will be recorded and will be included in the decision-making process for this project. Blair, I don't see any other attendees indicating they would like to make an oral comment at this time. Would you like to proceed?
Thank you, Laura. Yes, the record of the public hearing will be kept open until October 28th, 2020. So please submit any additional comments visiting scdhec.gov/Santee Cooper Johns Island and click on the submit a comment under downloads and links or provide your comment by email or mail by that date. Thank you all for attending tonight and have a good night.